soluble to insoluble, right? Okay. And you might need to know that we're two of these. Okay. So, we're changing gears a little bit. We've learned a lot so far. So now I want to start moving into kind of the more practical part of how we use this information to affect palatability, to affect fresh meat. And I told you I've kind of had to leave composition behind. Don't ever forget about composition, right? And you will get your exams back. You have one left to take it. And then I'll give the exams back, okay? So what we're going to start talking about, this is kind of I realize I only have you for two more weeks. I'll miss you at 8 in the morning. You probably won't miss me. But anyway, because you'll be eating with Dr. Kurt. But what I want to do with this lecture is talk about the four physical structural components that affect meat quality. And then we're going to talk about each one of those. The first one about is meat aging. And then we're going to talk about the process of rigor and how it affects it through cold shortening, heat shortening, and thaw rigor. And then we're going to talk about marbling and then the role of connective tissue, which we pretty much already talked about. But I'm going to try to put this into kind of the in perspective. Okay? So I decided to draw, to use a steer. This happens to be the perfect Simmental steer from 1982, so it's a little bit old, but I still like this steer. So meat scientists have been doing research since the early 1900s on meat quality, and I've actually read that research. It's really kind of fun. And the first work that they did, they noticed that there was a relationship between marbling and eating quality. Now, the first paper ever presented on that, in Journal of Animal Science, doesn't have a single table in it. There's no data. And then there was a textbook, Sleater Bull, in 1913. And when he talked about meat quality, he talked about marbling. That's all they knew at that time. So then so I like to think about this as eating quality is kind of like this steer. It's a puzzle. One piece of that puzzle is marbling. That was put in there in the early 1900s with actually no data. They said that, and they passed the USDA quality grades based on it. Pretty interesting, huh? And then by 1940, there's a little bit of data, there's one paper, but it isn't really substantial. And that's why Warner and Bratzler independently worked on an automated tenderness measure that emulated something that humans would do. So I've actually, Warner's thesis, he was a master's student at Kansas State. I've been able to look at it. We made RMC at Kansas State after the picnic. Dr. Janelle Yancey and I were like, Janelle's like, here is his thesis. Woo! So we looked at it. So that's a piece of the puzzle. If you would just read and knew nothing else but that early work from the 1900s, you would say that it's a big piece of the puzzle, but it's not. In fact, it's littler than what I show up there, but it's a piece of the puzzle. It's part of the information. Then they said the other thing is that meat from older animals is tougher, has more connective tissue. And so that's why age is in the quality grade standards as well. But then it wasn't until the 1960s, 70s that we started knowing something about connective tissue and connective tissue's contribution. So it's another piece of the puzzle. And we've learned most of what we're gonna learn about connective tissue. We're just gonna put it into practical application. And then we know that if we age meat, it becomes more tender. And that research really started in the late 70s, early 80s to look at that piece of the puzzle. So we're going to learn about that piece of the puzzle and how live animal standpoint, and then post-mortem, we can influence that. So we have three pieces of puzzle. But in the 1950s, over in England, they started, and in New Zealand, at a place called Marin's, they started looking at and playing with rigor mortis. And one of the things that happened was in World War II, the Australians were trying to ship lambs to the European troops, US troops, Australian troops, and to make it fresh, they froze it right away, and then the lamb was really, really tough and nobody liked it. And so they tried to understand what was really happening. And so a lot of that work, the initial work was done in England and New Zealand on contractile state of the muscle post-mortem. And how that muscle goes through rigor really has a big influence. And I want you to know, you think, well, all that's old stuff. You know what? It's still going on today. We haven't answered all of these, everything. And this red line I put there, and everything under here, don't have a clue, it's called job security for you. Okay. And actually, I've done lots of research with large groups of cattle from Deseret, from King Ranch, from actually other people as well, but those are the two main ones. And when we measure all four pieces of the puzzle and how it affects tenderness and quality, it only accounts for 10 to 20% of the total variation. So really, I should have that red line up at 20, so that those four pieces only account for 20%. And 80% is below the line. There's a lot of things that influence quality that are probably somewhat related. The other thing is, I make those four pieces, because they're the ones that we know the most about. I make them separate pieces there, but they probably have, there's some fuzzy lines in some of them. Contractile state and aging have a relationship. So we'll talk about some of that. So what I want to do is I want to talk about each of these four components. Then we're going to talk about pork quality, because we're going to talk about what their puzzle is. Then we're going to talk about pre- and post-harvest factors that influence those pieces of the puzzle. That's what we have in store for us for the rest of the semester with beef. So let's first talk about aging. Aging has gotten a lot of attention, especially the 80s and 90s. So let's talk about meat aging. And what meat aging is that as we, in refrigerated storage, not frozen, okay, frozen suspends it in time, okay, but at refrigerated storage, and meat freezes at 28 degrees Fahrenheit, not at 32, but 28. And so as long as the meat is not frozen, these are Warner Brasler shears. You've done shears in lab. You know a higher value means it's tougher. And this is from a very large study. There were 16 different sires in here. One was an Angus sire, that's the yellow. The red were 15 different Bothindica sires. These are all steers. They're all yearling fed. They're all over 5 years. We had calves from all those sires, not equally over 5 years, because sometimes the cows have more heifers. But anyway, so each dot on there represents a lot of steers, a lot of animals. They were all harvested at San Cain's, high voltage electrical stimulation. Everything was the same. And we brought the strip loins back here, and we cut steaks from them randomly, except for 14, and this was the 13th rib steak off the end, the anterior end of the loin. And it's always a little bit more tender, that's why there's a bleep there. But I'm a truist, so I can't move it up and cheat, because it just wouldn't be right, right? That's what the data says. So if you have a bone on it, it tends to be a little bit more tender, and that first steak is always a little bit more tender. But we cut steaks to the whole loin, randomly assigned them then to aging time of 1, 7, 14, 21, 28, 35 days. And we did this for 5 years. know is that with time, meat got more tender, didn't it? And actually, the Angus, let's look at the yellow first. The Angus, and this box means they would all be considered tender. Less than 3 kilograms, a little less than 6 pounds. Great tender. And so the Angus, the steaks from the Angus sired, and they were all on Hereford and Angus cows. So these were all F1s, and some of the Angus were sired off our Hereford cows as well. But notice that within 7 days, not only did they improve in tenderness, but you had most of the change in tenderness occur at that time. And if we go up to the red line, those animals, remember there's 15 different sires, there's a huge, huge N in there, but in general, they were tougher at the initiation, but it took them 14 days. And if they got into this box, they were not different in tenderness. So you can kind of think about those lines coming together, even though they aren't technically together, but they are statistically. So within 14 days, almost all of them were tender. There's variation, there's something wrong with it. So what's happening there? Why do we see this improvement in tenderness? And what we see is the biggest improvements occur in the first 14 days. Some less than that, but it takes at least 14 days. So that's the rule, minimum 14 days aging. When we set up the Go Texan process for guaranteed tender, been a few years, and so they said, well, what do you want to do? I'm like, this is the Texas Department of Ag. It's like, 14 days aging, must. It's my line in the sand. Can't be less. So the first question after we set up the parameters and got the program going, so I got a call and they said, HEB wants an exception on 14 days. Sorry, no, I know where they get their cattle. 14 days. No, they need 14 days. You can't put a Go Texan guaranteed tender unless they are 14 days aging. So Terry said, do you want to call them or do you want me to? I'm like, it doesn't matter. I can call them. I know them too. They know me. Whoever you think would be best to tell them that. But there are some things you can slack on. But if you want guaranteed tenderness, if you want it in a box, and that's what I told Terry, I said, if you want it in a box, it has to be in the box to get the label. It has to be aged 14 days. Because they're getting most of their cattle out of the sand cakes. So, now if this line was, these don't really show the trend, but you get subsequent improvements in tenderness. It doesn't really show here because of that blip with the 14 days. But it's not, that slope of the line really is almost, it's not level, but it's just, it changes, right? So 14 days is a must, and we'll get some subsequent aging with time. The best steak I ever had was a dry aged for like 50 days in Angus pasture outside of Washington, D.C., and so I even got up at 3 in the morning the next day when I had to fly out to go to the distributor, which is no longer there, Bay Street Beef, and look at their aging process because it was just so incredible, okay? And it was a it was great. So what's happening? What causes that to happen? So there are lots of things that, it's not a simple answer. We know that everything starts to fall apart. This is the termites going in, and I watch a lot of HGTV. You know, they find termite damage, right? You know, wood, everything. I'm like, that's like meat. So we want it to happen in meat. We want those structural proteins to fall apart. Well, what happens when you look at meat that's aged? You look at meat at 1 day and meat at 14 days. What we find is that the Z lines have fallen apart. So, aging, what happens? Z lines degrade. And then also troponin. Troponin starts to fall apart. And so we start to lose troponin. But also nebulin. And I see Desmond's not up there. Titan and Desmond, those structural proteins. Remember, Titan's holding up thick filaments. Nebulin's holding up the thin filaments. Desmond's strapping everything together, right? So they degrade. So, it's like all the nails rusted and all the screws and everything rusted, and so that the house can start falling apart. And these main structural proteins are what cause most of the changes. The changes you see in the Z line are because, Titan and Nebulin are attached to the Z lines, aren't they? So it's the clipping of them apart that really does that. What's interesting, and this 30,000 Dalton subunit, I'm not going to put that on the list. What that is it means if you're doing gel electrophoresis at 1 day and at 14 days, you start finding these little tiny fragments starting to appear. And one of them is 30,000 Dalton, which is the weight. And they've been able to show that that's actually a subunit of troponin. So what it means is things are falling apart. Okay? They're just starting to fall apart. Everything. And what's interesting is that actin and myosin don't degrade. They stay together. Remember those myosin heads, almost 100%? They're bound to those G actins, and they don't come apart. You have to use an enzyme like trypsin, which is pretty powerful, to pull them apart. And we're not going to talk about that. So what causes these changes? So the changes are caused by the first thing is something called calpains. Calpains are small proteolytic enzymes that are in the sarcoplasm. When you pull a muscle or your muscle needs to be repaired, calpains go in and clip out the muscle. The protein. Sorry, not the muscle, the protein. They're down inside the sarcoplasm. They clip out the protein and then it gets degraded into amino acids in the lysosome. Okay? Remember that lysosome from the first day? Well, it was actually about the third day. But anyway, the lysosome. So it's part of the natural process of protein degradation. Very important part of the protein degradation. So every cell in your body has calpains. And your brain has a lot. And your blood and your heart and your lungs have a lot of calpain. Because those are things you want to keep going at a good rate, right? And you want them all repaired really well. So when we talk about protein degradation, calpains are the first step in that. And there are two calpains. There's mu and m. So let's put calpain up here. And I think of them, they're the termites, okay? They're the termites. They go in and they clip things apart. And there are two forms, mu and m. And they actually are activated with calcium. So they need calcium to activate. Postmortem muscle, a lot of calcium. One of the things that's happening is the sarcoplasmic reticulum, it can't take calcium back up, right? No ATP, calcium pumps going, remember the little hinge sound of the calcium pump? It can't work. And then with cold temperatures, membranes are changed. Remember, the sarcoplasmic reticulum is a bipolar membrane, right? There are two little phospholipids, right? Two little heads here with their tails sticking in. And when they get cold, they get solid, right? Fat goes from being pretty liquid in the live animal to solid. Same thing happens to calcium activated. Well, here, early postmortem, first 24, 48 hours, no problem with calcium, lots of calcium, right? So they can be activated. Why are there two? Mucalpane needs a lot less calcium to activate. Micromolar, just a little bit. Mcalpane needs more calcium to be activated because they have different roles. And so mucalpane obviously is going to be activated, at least activated. And they, we actually know that we don't have enough enough calcium actually to activate M. If you pump calcium into the muscle, into early postmortem muscle, and it'll go and just shrink up and be really tender though, because all that calcium in there activates both M and mucalpane. But in real life, we don't do that. Do we? We try doing. You know what? You put it in there, calcium in there, works. Yeah. We did that to a bunch of old cows, top rounds. Anyway, so calcium activated, but mucalpane. And one of the things that we found out is that as we see that calpanes, they also self-destruct. We call it autolyse. So if they're active, they destroy themselves. And post-mortem, while all of these things are going on, M-calpane doesn't decrease in concentration, but mucalpane decreases in concentration. So it means it's working. Because it's self-destructive. So what about cathepsins and then lysosol? Used to be, and when I took my prelims many years ago, I talked about cathepsins because that's what we thought. And Chris Cockins, Dr. Chris Cockins at University of Nebraska, his dissertation here at Texas A&M was to see if electrical stimulation, high voltage electrical stimulation, was severe enough to rupture the lysosome and release cathepsins into the sarcoplasm. The answer is no, it doesn't. Because cathepsins, they degrade actin and myosin. Calpanes don't degrade actin and myosin. Calpanes degrade these two. So actin and myosin stay intact. That's an indication that cathepsins aren't working. Also, once all these proteins start to fall apart, remember I talked about that 30,000 Dalton subunit? I said you don't really need to know about that. But it tells us things are falling apart. Things are falling from the ceiling. Okay? So once things start to fall apart, so what happens with termite damage? If you watch Fixer Upper, you'd know this, right? But go watch this. But so once the termites start to do some damage, they loosen the structure. Then water comes in, and then you have water damage. And in one episode, the bees got in, and then the bees caused problems. So other things cause it to further degrade. And that's what ionic strength is. What ionic strength is free calcium, magnesium, free ions, because they're getting freed up, right? They're kind of floating around there, and they have charges. And if these structures are going into smaller units, and the structure's not as compact, and things aren't as organized, then they start to interfere. And we see a softening of actin and myosin. The heads don't, they're pretty rigid at first, but they kind of soften. And with really long time, after 28 days, glycoproteins, which hold the ground substance and the collagen fibers together, we see them start to loosen. So there's a lot going on, isn't there? It's a pretty complicated process. So let's talk a little bit more. I've already kind of introduced all this, but I haven't talked about calprotectin yet. So in your living cells, you have calpain. And calpain, you guys are probably all too young to know about Pac-Man, right? You know about Pac-Man? So think about calpain as this little Pac-Man, right? Going around. And they would just keep working. But they have to be released. Because if we didn't have something, we just threw all the Pac-Man in, we're supposed to eat so much protein a day so that we can do protein turnover, right? Which is degradation and synthesis, right? Degradation plus synthesis equals turnover. So what happens is that calpains are important in that degradation, but we have to control them because they're wild. They just go wild. Every time your muscle contracted and there's a calcium surge in the sarcoplasm, the muscles start to break down at the same time. Not good, right? That would not be good. And we'd have to eat so much protein, we'd never do anything but eat protein. So there is an inhibitor or a regulator, and that's calprotectin. So calpains are regulated by calprotectin. And what calprotectin does, you can think of it as like the floodgate. It turns it on and off. It says, yes, you can work, no, you can't. And so this picture kind of shows that. The shark is calpain, and the policeman's calprotectin. So in the normal cell, when there needs to be protein repair, policemen say, okay, sharks, come. Few of you come out here and work. They activate calpain. In postmortem muscle, after the process of rigor and during the process of rigor, calpain and calprotectin can't regenerate themselves. So whatever we have. That's it, right? And so calprotectin is sitting here saying, nope, don't work, don't work. But the calpains sit there and keep going, oh, I want to go in. And eventually the sharks are going to beat the policemen up, aren't they? Eat them up. And one thing is calprotectin is like calpain. It decreases in concentration with aging. Because it autolyses itself as well. Of the three things we have possible here, calprotectin, mu calpain, and M calpain, calprotectin and mu calpain are the two that we see degrade or decrease in concentration, which means they're doing something, right? They're doing something. And I hate measuring these. It's not a fun process. And this is what happens. This is what I was talking about when this is 0 day, well, 1 day age, and this is actually about, it's longer than 14. I think this would have to be 28 days age. But this is a Z-line, right? There's a Z-line, nice, organized, looks beautiful, doesn't it? And then look at this, and you can see some little fringes there. That's tight, and chitin or nebulin, one of the two, I don't know for sure, but fragments of it. This isn't because somebody couldn't make a good slide. It's what the slide looked like. So this is what aging does. We want to get to this point. We want the house to fall down, right? We want it to deteriorate so that when you apply pressure with your teeth, you have these Z lines right here are like steel girders. They're tougher. So So fewer, if we break those down, more tender, right? So when we see that improvement in aging, it's due to this. And we know that calpostatin decreases with aging, so the mucalpanes are working. The other thing that we know, and there were some people that didn't believe in all of this, and so what they said is, but mucalpanes, most of you probably haven't had your biochemistry where you had to do enzyme kinetics, but when we talked about enzymes, are maximally active at certain temperatures and pHs. That's why you, if you go to grad school, you have to learn about enzyme kinetics. I wish somebody would have told me why I needed to learn about it. But it's very fascinating because at physiological pH, post-mortem, it's going to be cold temperatures, right? 2 degrees C, and it's going to be a pH of about 5.6. So everybody thought that it was the cathepsins in the up to the 80s that were causing aging, because inside the lysosome, pH is 5.6, and they still are somewhat active at low temperatures. But mucalpane is actually 25% active. It doesn't lose all of its activity. And the same thing with calpostatin. It's about 25% active at 2 degrees C and 5.6 pH. So what that tells us is, not as strong as in the living cell, but still can work, right? And it can still work. My little puppies are walking. Three of them are really fat. Little Shiner, though, is quite active. And they, you know, we had to put their rat cages, right? What else would an owl scientist have for hay bales around where they stay at the, in the garage. And they created a little spot in hay bales, and the three chubby ones can't get there. But the shine one, he's a little bit diddler, he's a little bit precocious. And, you know, just at 3 weeks, he's already showing these signs, just like his dad. And they couldn't figure out how all of a sudden he'd be out in the middle of the garage. Well, because he wiggled through, right? And that's kind of what happens here. There's still some activity. There's still some activity. It's why it doesn't go bang and happen all at once. It happens gradually. And what's actually interesting is that most of the activity is in the first 48 hours. So just kind of breaking those structures apart is enough so that eventually house will fall down. And think about that with termites. You know, you don't need that many termites to cause damage. And then with time, the house falls apart. So that's what calpanes do. And they can still be active. So first they get rid of calpostatin. And then if there's a lot of calpostatin, they're going to not be able to work as well. But they get rid of calpostatin and then they work on the proteins. Okay? So, that's neat aging. Let's go now to the second piece of the puzzle, which is contractile state. And we've talked a lot about the process of rigor, so I'm going to put contractile state up here. I just want you to know that when I record those lectures and I can't write, I find it very frustrating. So, contractile state. When that muscle is converted to meat, we can have different, I guess, the rigor of the contractions can vary. We can change the physiological environment inside that muscle cell. And I want to talk about cold shortening first. So cold shortening happens when that muscle gets chilled too fast. So Paige, did this work when you guys did it in lab?
Oh, yay! Good.
So what happens is, while we're going through rigor, and we're in early onset, it gets below 15 degrees C. And 15, 16 degrees C seems to be 15 to 16. Don't worry, if you can remember one of them, you're probably fine. So if we are still in onset, and the closer we are to early onset, the more rigorous this result is. In onset, and less than 15 to 16 degrees C, the sarcoplasmic reticulum, the reason for that temperature, remember we talked about those, that bipolar membrane, right? At 15 to 16 degrees C, that's when that membrane starts to fall apart, because it gets too cold. And the phospholipids that are in the tails, they're in the center, they start to go solid. And it leaks. So, this is the most important point. The sarcoplasmic reticulum begins to leak calcium. And, you know, how onset goes like this, the earlier in onset, the bigger that effect is. Because there's more ATP, there's more things that can go on. And so it isn't a huge tsunami, but it is a flood, all right? And this is a flood of calcium. And so we get a rigorous contraction because there's everything. Calcium's bounding out there and it's attaching to more troponin. And boy, you can just like, right? And using ATP up so much because it gets all of those myosin heads, instead of 20%, and then it's slowly going down, it just all goes off. And it's stuck. So, flood of calcium, which causes rigorous contractions, and we have shorter sarcomere. A normal sarcomere length is about 2.0 microns. Cold shortened, 1.8 microns. Did you get the sarcomere to work in lab? No. That length's pretty old. That isn't a very big change, but it's enough to make those steel girders more dense. And you tasted it, right? You tasted it and it was tougher. So it's real. The first time I saw cold shortened carcasses was a cow facility in Pueblo, Colorado when I was on the judging team. We went down there to learn about maturity. And it's a cow plant. Their coolers are the cold. It was a few years, but I still remember it to this day because there was ice hanging from the carcasses. And it was so cold. The air velocity was really high. And it was just freezing in there. But what was funny is that when you looked at the carcasses, the split carcasses went down and then the necks curled up. And there was actually ice in the neck. And we're all like, our judging team coach is like, settle down. We could take the icicles off. That's how cold it was. Why are the necks curled? Cold shortening. Because they didn't care about cold shortening, because they're going to debone everything and throw it to the ground, right? So, and that was fine for them. They weren't worried about it. But the rigor of that was that's in the past. So, hold short. All of this because it is that sarcoplasmic reticulum leaking calcium that stimulates that. And so the calcium flows into the system. Notice I put some of this up on the slide so that you'd have it for your notes. We know that animals that are heavier, fatter, or more muscular are going to have less of this effect inherently. And that's because they chill slower. It's harder to get them to chill. So cold shortening in today is really not much of a problem because we have such heavy hearts. And when we, you can still see cold shortening in cow carcasses, but then who cares? We still use ES, mainly in the blood pit, to help with exsanguination, but it also helps to start rigor. And we'll talk about how ES helps to prevent cold shortening. Okay? So that's where we're going to stop for today. We'll finish up on Wednesday. We'll do thaw rigor, and then we'll get into the quality grade, and we'll finish this up on Wednesday. And we may, and we should start on pork quality, just a few slides on pork quality. Okay? All right, great. Thank you so much. Have a great day. Hopefully my son moves his car.